We see Vanessa hanging in her cell because she is a slave and this is where she sleeps. Venti comes and breaks her out, and they begin to have a chat for a bit. And he offers a way to get her to be set free. And Vanessa won't take it because she's only thinking of her sister Lint. And Venti begins to speak behind him. The children of Murata, the Lady of Fire, a hardy people blessed with a head of fiery red hair, but they are few in number and seldom seen in the north. Venti realizes her heritage and says that the Muratan people are incredibly strong, that live in the volcanic regions, and that he is surprised to see her here and wants to help her escape. But as I've already mentioned, she won't do it because of Lint. And she says she has one more battle to go before it happens. And in the process, she begins to reveal, in the process of their dialogue, she reveals that the Muratan people were scattered about and they were taken up as slaves by anyone that finds them wandering, because Ursa the Drake, the same name that we saw earlier, same Drake, came and attacked their village and left them wandering and squandering around, and they were left starving. She was a little girl there then and picked up to be a slave. We see that Venti is carrying the Dur-Hamel with him, so this is well before the times of the Traveler. And funnily enough, we have this one panel right here, or right before it says, "How about this? Will you be my friend, Vanessa?" And she goes, "Friend? I suppose we can start with that." Very, very interesting. Someone has a little crush on some Vente. And here we see the first tidbit of I was talking about in the first chapter. I won't spoil too much that comes after this chapter because it won't be in this video. But we see that her ancestors were telling her about the area that is Celestia, and that the gods will choose mortals to come up and be immortal. And as she begins to tell Venti about this, he acts as if he is shocked. And the pictures that we see is actually him worried about her knowing about Celestia and her interest in Celestia. And he says there's plenty of times for song about Celestia, because he wants to actually, as you see here, or right up here, he asks her to impart more onto him about Celestia, so he can understand what they know about the area. And this is when she begins to talk about again that she has one more battle left before she can be freed, and Lord Barca will free her. And Venti's like, "No, they won't do it. You need to come with me, be safe." And she's like, "No, I must do it. I must be free. I must set my people free. If I was to run away with you, my people would not be free." And then the day comes, and she and her people are taken to the arena in which they have to do their final fight. And Lord Lawrence hereby announces that her final challenger will be Ursa the Drake, which obviously she will not win. In her own right, he is so sure of this that he says, "I will hand over the property and the keys of Mondstadt to you, and I am not generous." So if she was to win, she would have the keys to Mondstadt. Mondstadt would be in her name. But in that moment, when she saw the Drakes arrive, she knew that she was going to die. Being the good warrior that she is, she decides to group up all of the old and young to try to keep them away from the battle, so she can try to fight those in front of them. But they're getting rained down on by arrows from those of the crowd, because Lord Lawrence didn't make the promise that he wouldn't intervene. So now she has to fight hilly trolls, Ursa the Drake, and the townspeople of the city. And if she can win this fight, she gets her freedom. But obviously she's going to die. But in the end, we see that the savior comes, and we see Venti in his true form here. And that's when she realizes that Venti is not Venti. He is the Lord of the Wind, the Archon of the Wind, Barbados, the Wind God. And in that moment, the Wind God comes and saves her from the Drake, and then forces the hands of Mondstadt to give over the keys to Vanessa and her people, because of the rules that they had catered to. And then Venti begins to sing a beautiful song about Vanessa, but then you see that he stops rhyming and he gets super serious. And he embarks on us the tale that is Celestia and how it goes to be, that the people that reach immortality through this actually do not reach immortality in the way that we think. We see that the people that transcended to Celestia, their bodies became things such as rivers and seas and mountains, They become cut apart and they are sacrificed to make the earth what it is. So much so that the brain of the giant Ymir became the clouds, and Pengu became to the rivers and seas. Persia began to be the mountains. Their sacrifices seeded life in the unliving cosmos. These songs sing of the primeval ones. And she looks disinterested, staring up at the sky. And then we see her take form, called into Celestia as an eagle. And it is applied by Venti that as he stares into the eyes of this eagle, she's still keeping watch over Mondstadt after all of these years. And that is the bard's tale that he embarks on, the Traveler. And he says, now I wonder if the world became a little bit stronger. She always hoped to see that happen. And the interesting notes here, there's only one character that has an eagle in the game, is Diluc. So maybe Vanessa is blessing Diluc. I haven't really read too much further than this, guys, so my ability to spoil the story is not that high, but it is seeming very relevant that Vanessa is a character we may see in the game. As she herself is one of the members of Celestia, she makes up the eagles. She became the eagles, and the eagles are blessing Diluc in his Muritan blood in Mondstadt. As we know from Diluc, his family comes from a very rich heritage. Vanessa actually was the owner of Mondstadt for a short period of time. So obviously the Muritan people had a tremendous ruling class over it. And we know that Diluc has himself a pet eagle. So, very interesting stuff. If this video is liked by you guys, we will go ahead and push through the story. There are several chapters already online for you to read on Webtoon, and we can break down exactly what it is that we've picked out from this, how we relate it to the Genshin Impact game. And if that's of interest to you, let me know. If you found something in these that I didn't see, or even if you've read the whole thing and you found little tidbits for us to pick up on throughout this, knowing what you know in the future, spoilers are welcome in the comments. So if you're watching this video and you don't want to be spoiled about what's left to come, just skip the comments, guys. Thanks for watching. We'll talk soon. Bye.